and a lack of understanding of the difference between the races and how the races think and serving them. Because when we moved into this station right here, this area was in transition. Everything's on the other side of Westlake. Everything on the other side of Westlake Avenue was white. You would not believe everyone was white, and people were moving. They were in transition. They were running away from the city because the city had turned black. Because City Hall was black, trying to turn black. And my lawsuit really helped that to go black in 10 months' time. And that was another miracle, you know. But what happened was we came in this station, we would go to fight fire all the time. I mean, we were never in the station for any longer than maybe a couple of hours or 3 hours. We were running. Because people were moving into houses that had fireplaces and things like that that had never been used, and they were coming in using the fireplace, setting the house on fire, and we could stand out on the ramp and look at fires coming. It was just that many people moving into the exit, because all of Bankhead from Ashby Street, which is Lowry Boulevard, was white. Going back to the west, and oh my goodness, we would go over there, and I would never forget one of our truck drivers lived off of Bankhead. It was Otis Tumbling. He was a truck driver. He was an old man, needed to be retired, and he lived off of Bankhead, right over there at Florence and Bankhead. And he later moved out where he thought blacks could not move. His son built him a house out Fairburn Road. And lo and behold, blacks engulfed him again. I used to drive by and laugh. I look over there and see him sitting on the porch, I'd laugh. I wouldn't even stop, I'd just drive on. Oh gosh, yeah. I for 5 years. I miss being on the fire department tremendously because when I retired, it took me 5 years to adjust to not having an office, not being in office, not receiving calls, and not making decisions. And because see, I was a hands-on manager. I would go to fire scenes. I would take over control of the fire. I would do everything because I listened to the fire all the time. Whatever, I never forget, I was at home and I was watching the fire scene on the television. And they were up on the roof, firefighters were up on the roof, and the fire was engulfing it. And I knew they shouldn't have been on the roof. I called the dispatcher and told them, I said, we responded to the fire. We went to the fire, and I told them we got them. The dispatcher called them and told them to get off the roof because Chief Amon was on the way. And he said he ordered everybody off the roof of that building. And so they got off the roof and we had a problem, yeah. So that was how I was a hands-on operator. I believed in that because I like to see things run properly, and I was all by the rule book. And that kept me out of trouble. It kept me from overstepping my bounds and also having anybody interfere with my operation. Well, the biggest change for me was to get adjusted, because I was in administration working as a firefighter, and I was a driver. I had driver's pay and everything, but I was working as a acting battalion chief or a deputy chief at that point. And when I became chief, I had set up an organization where I had my administrative assistant, which was a female. I appointed her because I saw her And I knew I was going to be chief, and I told her, I said, you know, I said, one of these days, I said, when I be chief, when I become chief, I said, I'm going to make you my secretary. And she was just a stenographer in there. She said, you kidding me? And she just laughed, and I walked on. And lo and behold, 2 years later, I was chief. And she was my